Hello students, in this video we are going to see estimation of quinine sulfate by fluorimetry, which is one of the practicals under instrumental method of analysis. So before moving on to actual practical, let us see what is fluorimetry. So fluorimetry or fluorescence spectroscopy or spectrofluorometry, it is a type of electromagnetic spectroscopy that analyzes fluorescence from a sample. So this technique is basically going to involve a beam of light, and usually this light is the ultraviolet light, that is the radiations ranging from 200 to 400 nanometer, that excite the electrons in the molecules of certain compounds and causes them to emit light. And this emitted light is generally of the visible light. Okay, so not all the compounds show fluorescence, only certain compounds, and that too aromatic compounds show fluorescence. So let us now see what is fluorescence. Substances absorb the light of some color, which is generally referred to as excitation. Then they instantaneously radiate light of another color, one of the lower energy, and this is known as emission. So fluorescence spectroscopy is primarily concerned with the electronic and vibrational states. Generally, the species which we are examining, it has a ground electronic state, that is a lower energy state, and an excited electronic state of higher energy. Now within this lowest energy state and the higher energy state, there are certain electronic states often referred to as vibrational states. So in fluorescence, the species is first excited by absorbing a photon from its ground electronic state to one of the various vibration states in the excited electronic state. Collisions with other molecules cause the excited molecule to lose the vibrational energy. And this energy will be lost until it reaches the lowest vibrational state from the excited electronic state. The molecule then drops down to one of the various vibration levels of the ground electronic state again. So you can see from excited state, they are dropping down again to the ground electronic state. And during this process, they emit a photon. So let us see the Jablonski diagram depicting fluorescence. So here you can see electrons going from the ground state to the excited state by gaining energy. Then they drop to the lower vibrational state, and this is the non-radiative transition. From the lower vibrational state, they drop down to the ground state, and during this they emit light and hence they show fluorescence. So here S0 and S1, they represent the spin states. Let us see the instrumentation for fluorimetry. So this is the block diagram. So first you can see light source, then excitation monochromator, then sample cell, then a slit, then emission monochromator, then detector, amplifier and recorder. So here you can see two monochromators are used, unlike UV. You can see the excitation and emission monochromator. So light sources which are generally used are lasers, LED and lamps. Lamps, it includes your xenon arc lamp and mercury vapor lamps. Filters, as we have already discussed, two filters. One is known as primary filter and another is the secondary filter. So primary filter is also known as excitation filter or incident light filter. So this filter is basically going to isolate the wavelength that will cause the compound to fluoresce. That is, it allows the light of our interest to incident on the sample. Next is the secondary filter. It isolates the desired emitted light, that is the fluorescent light. Next part is your sample cells. They are meant for holding the samples and they are generally made up of quartz. They are cylindrical in shape. Detectors, here barrier layer cell or photovoltaic cell and photomultiplier cells are generally used as the detector. So here you can see the actual instrument. So you can see the control panel, coarse, sensitivity, fine, and then one is for calibration. And you can see the window which shows the readings of fluorescence intensity. So this is a digital photofluorimeter. So coarse and fine adjustment knobs. With these knobs, we can set 0 for the blank and 100 for the highest concentration. Next button you can see is the sensitivity. So as per our sample, we can adjust the sensitivity as 1, 2, 3 and 4. On the upper top, you can see a black cover. Under which we insert our sample holder containing the sample. And besides that, you can see a black knob. So whenever we are recording the reading, we have to keep this knob in the pressed position. Only in pressed position, the light passes through the sample. So this is how the actual instrument looks like. Now let us have a look on the filters. So you can see the various filters, you can see different colors. So based on our sample, we can choose the desired primary and secondary filters. So now let us see the actual practical. So aim is to perform estimation of quinine sulfate by fluorimetry. So we would require apparatus like volumetric flask, both of 100 ml capacity as well as 10 ml capacities, then pipettes, rubber bulbs, beakers, weighing balance, spatula, etc. Chemicals, we are going to require quinine sulfate, sulfuric acid and distilled water. Instrument, obviously it is the fluorometer, the digital fluorometer. You can see here the structure of quinine sulfate. As you can see, it is a highly aromatic compound. Its molecular weight is 746.9 gram per mole. Uses, so it is the well-known anti-malarial drug. So basically this was the first drug invented to treat malaria. So its uses are to treat malaria and muscle cramps. So now let us see the principle of our practical. When any molecule absorbs UV visible radiation, its electrons transmit from singlet ground state to singlet excited state. And obviously this excited state is not at all stable. Thus, the electrons, they emit radiation and return to the stable singlet ground state, because any system or any electron has a tendency to return to the stable state. Hence, it emits radiation and returns to stable singlet ground state from the excited state. So, this is known as fluorescence. And fluorescence, we can measure with the help of fluorometer. The emitted radiation, that is fluorescent intensity, it is directly proportional to the concentration of the substance present. So higher the concentration of the substance, higher will be the fluorescent intensity. Quinine sulfate, our drug, is fluorescent in acidic solutions like 0.1 normal sulfuric acid. So we are going to estimate the concentration of unknown sample of quinine sulfate with help of fluorometry. and we are going to prepare the solutions in 0.1 normal H2SO4, because as you can see, quinine sulfate is fluorescent in the acidic solutions. So now let us see the procedure. So first is preparation of 0.1 normal H2SO4. For this we have to add 5.4 ml of concentrated H2SO4 to 100 ml of water and dilute up till 1 liter. So we will get 1 liter or you can say 1000 ml of 0.1 normal sulfuric acid. In this sulfuric acid we are going to dissolve quinine sulfate and for further dilutions. Now how to prepare standard solution? So weigh accurately 100 mg of quinine sulfate powder drug. Transfer this weighed amount into the volumetric flask. Dissolve it in 100 ml of 0.1 normal H2SO4. So we are dissolving 100 mg in 100 ml of solvent. So the concentration is going to be 1 mg per ml, or you can say 1000 microgram per ml. So this is our stock solution. From stock solution we are going to further make diluted solutions. So from this 1000 microgram per ml of quinine sulfate, take 10 ml solution and dilute to 100 ml again with 0.1 normal H2SO4. From this solution again take 10 ml and dilute to 100 ml with 0.1 normal H2SO4. Now we have to prepare the working standard solutions. So our working standard solutions are 0.5 microgram per ml, 1 microgram per ml, 1.5, 2 and 2.5 microgram per ml. So for this we have to take in the 10 ml volumetric flask. In each volumetric flask we have to take 0.5, 1, 1.5, 2 and 2.5 ml of the above solutions and dilute each of the solution to 10 ml with 0.1 normal H2SO4. So we will get our resulting working standard solutions. Now how to prepare the sample solution? So pipette out 1 ml of the given unknown sample solution and make up the volume to 10 ml with 0.1 normal H2SO4. So now we are having standard solutions and sample solution. So we are going to measure the fluorescence intensity first of standard solutions and then the sample solution. Now how to operate the instrument? So switch on the instrument and set the excitation and emission filters, that is primary and secondary filters, at 3486 angstrom and 4308 angstrom respectively. Now first of all, what we have to do, set the fluorescence intensity to 0% by using 0.1 normal H2SO4 as blank. Now as you have seen that we have prepared the dilutions in H2SO4, so blank is going to be our H2SO4. So we have to set the fluorescence intensity to 0% by using 0.1 normal H2SO4. And then we have to set fluorescence intensity to 100% by using the highest concentration of the standard solution. So highest concentration of our working standard solution is 2.5 microgram per ml. So with this we are going to set the fluorescence intensity to 100%. Once we have done this, we have to measure the fluorescence intensity of different standard solutions and finally our sample solution. Then plot the graph of concentration versus fluorescence intensity. From this graph, we are going to determine the concentration of unknown sample by extrapolating the fluorescence intensity of the sample solution on x-axis. So first we are going to prepare 0.1 normal H2SO4, then stock solution of quinine sulfate. From this we are going to further prepare other dilutions like 100 microgram per ml and 10 microgram per ml from 10 microgram per ml of solution, we are going to prepare our working standard solutions, that is 0.51, 1.52 and 2.5 microgram per ml of the solutions. Then we are going to prepare the sample solution, and then finally we are going to measure the fluorescence intensity of standard as well as the sample solutions. So now let us see how to perform the actual practical.
Hello students, now we are going to see how to perform estimation of vinyl sulfate with help of the fluorometer. So now let us have a look on the instrument. So this is your, as you can see, digital photofluorometer. LabTech is its make and model. So fluorometer contains two types of filter, primary filter and secondary filter, that is one is excitation and one is emission. So you can see we are going to estimate quinine sulfate. So we have used primary filter 3486 and secondary filter we have used is 4308. So various other filters are also available. So which filter to use, it depends on our sample. This is the sample holder and we are going to place it here in this fashion. And whenever we record the readings, we have to press this button. So you can see when we press this button, the light passes through the sample holder. So during taking the reading, we have to keep this button in the pressed mode. Now let us see which samples we have prepared. So first of all, we have prepared the quinine sulfate standard solution, 1000 microgram per ml. This is our stock solution. From that, we have prepared 100 microgram per ml of quinine sulfate, then 10 microgram per ml of quinine sulfate. From this, we have prepared other dilutions. So concentration 0.5 microgram per ml, 1 microgram per ml and likewise. And this is the unknown concentration, that is our sample. So what we are going to do, we are going to note the fluorescence intensity of all the samples, then we will plot a calibration curve of fluorescence intensity versus the concentration. And from the graph, we are going to find out the concentration of unknown. Now we have prepared this dilutions in 0.1 normal H2SO4 because quinine sulfate gives fluorescence in H2SO4. So obviously our blank will be 0.1 normal H2SO4. Now we are going to record the readings. So first we are going to set 0 with help of the blank. So our blank is 0.1 normal H2SO4. So fill the cuvette. Place your sample holder and now we will press this button and we are going to set 0 with help of the coarse and fine adjustment knobs. Now you can see we have adjusted 0 with help of the blank, that is 0.1 normal H2SO4. Okay, so now we will discard this into the waste. Now we are going to set 100 with the help of highest concentration. So this is our highest concentration, 2.5 microgram per ml. There is no need to rinse because we have used H2SO4 earlier. We can fill the covered up to 70%. Now we are going to adjust 100 so you can see we have adjusted 100 with help of the highest concentration. So now we are going to take the reading of our first standard solution. So this is our first standard solution, 0.5 microgram per ml. We will rinse it because we have used higher concentration before this. Now we will keep this into the sample holder and we will note down the reading. So we will press the button. So you can see the reading is 19. So we will note down this fluorescence intensity and now we will take the reading of subsequent sample. As we have seen in UV, it uses only one filter. For fluoro, we are using two filters. One is excitation and one is emission. So wipe it, place it. So again, press the button. So you can see the reading is 41. Now we will take our next solution. So now this is our next higher concentration. Rinse it. Again, press the button. So now you can see the reading is 60. Similarly, take the reading of next concentration. So always rinse the sample holder before taking the subsequent readings. Again, press this button. So you can see the reading is 79. Okay, so now we have taken the readings of all the prepared standard solutions. We had already set 100 with help of the highest concentration. So now we are going to take the reading of unknown. This is our unknown concentration of quinine sulfate. Okay. Now again press the button. So you can see the reading is 65. So note down this reading. Okay. So now we have taken reading of unknown. Now we are going to put this value into the graph which we will obtain by the plotting readings of our standard solutions. And from the graph by extrapolation, we are going to find out the concentration of our unknown solution.
Now let us see the observation table. So you can see for 0 microgram per ml of quinine sulfate, that is blank, we had adjusted fluorescence intensity to 0%, and for 2.5 microgram per ml we had adjusted fluorescence intensity to 100%, as it is the highest concentration of our working standard solution. For 0.5 we observed that the intensity was 19%, for 1 microgram per ml intensity was 41%, for 1.5 microgram per ml intensity was 60%, for 2 microgram per ml it was 79%, for 2.5 microgram per ml it was 100%, which we had adjusted. For unknown, the intensity was found to be 65%. So now we are going to plot the graph of fluorescence intensity versus the concentration. So let us see the graph. You can see on y-axis it is percentage fluorescence intensity, on x-axis it is concentration in microgram per ml. So based on our readings, we have plotted the graph. So as you can see, as the concentration increases, fluorescence intensity also increases. For unknown, we got 65 fluorescence intensity, 65%. So we are going to extrapolate 65% fluorescence intensity on x-axis. So you can see, we will draw a horizontal line from 65%. Then from the point where it meets the linear curve, our standard linear line, we are going to extrapolate it downwards. So on extrapolating, you can see that the concentration of unknown sample solution is found to be 1.6 microgram per ml. So the result for our practical is the concentration of unknown solution is found to be 1.6 microgram per ml. So concentration of unknown quinine sulfate solution is 1.6 microgram per ml. Now let us see some of the questions for synopsis. So how many filters are used in fluorimeter? So we have seen two filters are used, emission and excitation. Excitation, that is primary filter, and emission, that is secondary filter. Differentiate between fluorescence and phosphorescence. So for fluorescence, it is the absorption of energy by atoms or molecules followed by immediate emission of light, or you can say electromagnetic radiation. Whereas phosphorescence, it is also the absorption of energy by atoms or molecules, but it is followed by delayed emission of electromagnetic radiation. Fluorescence is immediate emission, whereas phosphorescence is delayed emission. In fluorescence, the emission of radiation or light suddenly stops on the removal of source of excitation. That is, once you remove the source of excitation, the emission of radiation stops immediately. Whereas in phosphorescence, the emission of radiation remains for some time even after the removal of source of excitation. In fluorescence, the excited atom has comparatively short lifetime before its transition to lower energy state. Whereas in phosphorescence, the excited atom has comparatively long lifetime before its transition to lower energy state. In fluorescence, the time period of interval between absorption and emission is very short. Whereas in phosphorescence, this time interval between the absorption and emission of energy is comparatively longer. Absorption process in fluorescence, it occurs over a short time interval and involves the transition from ground state to singlet excited state and do not change the direction of the spin. It is spin multiplicity is not changed. Whereas in phosphorescence, it involves the transition from single ground state to the excited triplet state, involving a change of spin state or spin multiplicity. So what is singlet and triplet state? So in singlet state, all the electrons in the molecules are spin paired. It is called a singlet because there is only one possible orientation in the space. In triplet state, one set of electron spins is unpaired. It is called triplet because there are three possible orientations in the space with respect to the axis. So in the diagram, you can see the ground singlet state. Next, excited singlet state. So you can see the spins are paired. Whereas in triplet state, the spins are unpaired. Next question is, name a continuous radiation source using fluorimetry. So it is the xenon arc lamp. Which class of compound shows highest fluorescence? So aromatic compounds, they show highest fluorescence. Next question is, give the applications of fluorimetry. So it is used for determination of inorganic substances like aluminium cation, lithium cation and zinc cation. Then determination of thiamine HCl, that is vitamin B1. Then determination of phenytoin. So phenytoin, it is one of the well-known anti-epileptic drug. Then determination of indoles, phenols and phenothiazines. Also used for determination of naphthols, proteins, plant pigments and steroids. And nowadays fluorimetry, it can also be used in detection of impurities in nanogram level. Thank you.